It's difficult to talk about apparel without also talking about materials, and that quickly leads to conversations about sustainability. Not so much about the need to use more sustainable materials. Most people are pretty clear on that. The challenge is how to check all the boxes, and there are a lot, that brands need to check these days. I'm Jane Singer, and welcome to A Seat at the Table. The question so many brands struggle with is how to meet requests for better performance, better hand feel, visual appeal, and of course, sustainability. So I reached out to Veronica Pagani, a leading expert on material sourcing, to find out how she manages that complex equation. Veronica was Vice President of Raw Material Sourcing at Ralph Lauren for 15 years before leaving last year to start her own consulting business, Studio VP. She's worked with suppliers around the world and has been challenged to meet the stringent standards that are part of working for a major brand that faces constant pressure to be more sustainable, meet strict compliance standards, work on tight deadlines, while also being innovative in terms of performance and design. Speaking of materials, before we get started, if you're looking for a well-edited selection of top-quality products that are filled with creativity, then Spin Expo is the place to go. It's the primary exhibition for yarns and knitwear. It's also the top resource for precise trend information that cannot be found anywhere else. To learn more, go to spinexpo.com. That's spinexpo.com. You can also find a link in the show notes. I'm also pleased to announce that A Seat at the Table now has its own website where you can find the show notes, access to all of the podcast episodes, and other useful information. You can find it at www.seat.fm. That's www.seat.fm. FM because it's a podcast. Now let's sit down with Veronica and talk about material sourcing. I'm so excited to have you on the podcast today. There's so much going on in the apparel industry right now, and I think that one of the biggest topics is materials.
Absolutely.
When you look at it, materials have moved from a supporting role to a key role in apparel. From driving better quality to checking the box on sustainability, smart brands are putting the spotlight on materials nowadays. It used to be that materials were in the background, and now you see so many product descriptions that really call out the materials.
Absolutely. The material is, the fabric is the biggest component of the garment, so it's only natural that it has to be the one of the most important together with the construction of the garment. They have to work together. They have to make sense together.
Yeah, absolutely. As an industry expert in running material sourcing at Ralph Lauren and plus other industry experience you've had in production and sourcing, I wanted to reach out to you and discuss your views on what is some of the shifts in materials, where you see the industry heading, and what are some of the opportunities for brands and retailers.
Absolutely. I'm so excited to talk about this topic today.
Oh, that's great. So, you know, why don't we start with what is the biggest challenge, in your opinion, when you're sourcing raw materials for a high-end brand like Ralph Lauren or even for a mid-tier brand? What are you seeing?
Yes, Jane, I have to tell you, working for a high-end brand and a huge corporation, but even like you said, in the mid-tiers, has incredible advantages in terms of the strength of the brand that's behind you and the purchasing power with the vendors. But it also comes with great challenges. And I have to say, it has changed so much in the past 15, 20 years. The landscape out there has become much more complex. The complexity that we're facing nowadays when we're talking about materials, it's incredible. It has so many aspects to it. The biggest challenge, in my opinion, has always been, but like I said, has increasingly been having the material checking all the necessary boxes. And I can explain what that means. The brands have been putting the consumer at the center of the equation, which makes complete sense. With that, that has brought up a lot of parameters that we need to look at the same time. There is an interest and a necessity to have high-end quality fabric, first choice fabrics, obviously. There is the sustainable aspect of the fabric that, as we all know, is gaining an incredible momentum, thankfully, and it will even more in the future. There is the performance aspect of it. More and more, everybody's looking for the fabric to be performance as well. But with that, it goes also the compliance aspect. And at the same time, when working for a high-end brand, you need to satisfy a certain aesthetic as well. You have to satisfy a very refined design sensibility. Put all these ingredients together with an extreme pressure on price, an extreme pressure on reducing AUC, average unit cost, and an extreme pressure on lead times. We're working on calendars that are very difficult to adhere to. That, when you put all these ingredients together, it's extremely challenging to find materials that can check all of them off. The necessity of sourcing sustainable materials, for example, at cost neutral, the expectations are very high, and it's becoming more and more difficult to deliver something that can make all the stakeholders happy at the same time, all the cross-functional team on the same page.
Yeah, I can imagine. That's, like you said, that's a lot of boxes that you have to check and a lot of people who you have to satisfy, each with a different priority, so to speak. So it's not
exactly
particularly easy to do. Is that leading more to using more natural fibers, do you think?
Personally, I'm a big believer in natural fibers. Sustainable aspects of the materials out there are so many. The landscape of the sustainability market right now, it's huge. It's becoming more and more complex. And there are so many stories that every vendor has that has a sustainable aspect to it. It's only normal that it's getting extremely confusing for the brands to decide what material to use and what story to tell. And also there is a fear, I feel, from the brand, from the retailer point of view, to come out with the wrong message. There's a fear to get negative press. And that's because the sustainable market, like we said, has so much to offer right now. So it's hard to understand what you should pick and what story you should tell to your consumer. That's why I agree that going back to the natural fiber is the safer way, but also going back to the basic, the beauty of the natural fibers and understanding and utilizing the performance that's always been associated with the natural fiber. Just think about the performance of the wool without anything added to it. And that kind of, it checks off the box of sustainability. Obviously, we need to look at the entire supply chain and look at the farming practices being done humanly and biodiversity and all that when we're talking about water consumption, when we're talking about cotton. So the natural fibers have their own challenges as well. But if the farmers and the growers check off their own boxes, it's probably one of the best ways to satisfy the sustainable attributes and requests from the consumer is to offer the natural fiber. The approach to sustainability, you can approach the sustainability in so many different ways that there is a lot of confusion out there. And the process to get to the end result of weaving a fabric, it's so long and there's so many touch points and there's so many things that can go wrong that it's not easy to come out with a unified message about sustainability.
I think that's a very good point. And it's interesting because just in 2020, U.S. Cotton launched what they call their U.S. Cotton Trust Protocol, which actually is a third-party certification that the cotton actually is grown to meet all those measures that you said, using less water and, you know, so on, meeting all the sustainability criteria. So I think that's very interesting that you brought that up because I think it is very confusing because, like you said, so many mills have come out with different sustainable, whether it be fibers or whether it be fabrics, and it is very difficult to understand when you're really hitting the mark because this one is saying they're using cleaner chemistry. That one is saying they're using less water and less energy. Someone else is saying a different story altogether. So using recycled fiber, for example. So yeah, yes, it's very difficult to sort it all out, like you're saying. And at the same time, I think another point you made was that brands are afraid of making a claim and then finding out, right, that somebody found a flaw, so to speak, in their supply chain. And then they get a huge amount of bad publicity and everybody's calling them out on that. So you're right. It's, you want to do the right thing and then you end up getting in trouble.
Exactly. And there is also the big landscape of the certifications that the brands are relying right now on this complex certification system that hopefully doesn't just become a meaningless tick box mechanism. Because again, there's so many out there and we are asking all the vendors to be certified in all these different things and everybody has a different requirement to get to these certifications that, again, going back to basics and going back to valuable materials, I have to say the vendors have been doing a great amount of work a lot earlier than when the retailers and the brands have decided to join the sustainability train. The European vendors have been certified to recycle the polluted air and waters that go back into the rivers and lakes for many years, thankfully.
Yeah.
Thanks to this, nowadays we can join, the brands and the retailers can join the train of the sustainability, and we can tell some of these stories, and some are extremely, extremely compelling. Recycling the clams from the lake and the exoskeleton of the clams and making a natural substitute of the acrylic resins. There's so many amazing realities out there, thankfully. But I agree, it's up to the brand, it goes back to knowing and investigating the supply chain and investigating the statements that everybody's making before you come out to the consumer. It's absolutely imperative right now.
Yeah, that's very true. So how, as a brand, how do you set up a framework, in a sense, to determine whether or not what you're getting is the right thing for you?
Yeah, that's a good question. It's really not easy to answer. I think, in my opinion, establishing a partnership with the vendor, it's almost one of the most important things that a brand can do nowadays. There's definitely an influx of materials out there. There's definitely, everybody is capable of offering pretty much everything. Partnering with the right vendor, it's key, and communicating and going through this journey with your vendor, becoming a partner, I think it's extremely important to understand each other's limitations and to understand each other's needs. And it's not anymore just issuing POs to your mill and hoping that everything goes right. You really have to hold hands very closely to make sure that you are sourcing the materials, the vendor is sourcing the materials for you the right way in a timely manner, and checking off the boxes that you decide your consumer will want to see. It all goes back to who is your consumer, who ultimately you're selling to, and what is the consumer going to be looking for in your garments, right? So you need to know that very well in order to decide what you want to offer as a performance or as a sustainable attribute to your garment. Because sometimes you're thinking you're offering something, but your consumer is really not interested in it. And that's very true. I think transparency is absolutely the key word, as we have learned even from the latest happenings in the world. Transparency is imperative. It's not, like we said before, we have to partner with our vendors, and there has to be a huge investment in the entire supply chain to provide the technologies that are necessary to trace back the materials, to avoid everything that we know could go wrong. That's just the tip of the iceberg. The industry has changed tremendously. So the expectation to change the materials into sustainable materials in a matter of few years, it's not really realistic. There has to be a holistic view of sustainability. There has to be a re-engineering of the processes around it. Only expecting that the material all of a sudden is sourced in a sustainable way, it's not necessarily the most important thing. It's important to go back and look at all the process of your supply chain, to look at all the players, the fabric, the materials, they, like we said, they have so many touch points that it's so easy for something to go wrong. And again, transparency to avoid bad surprises. And it goes back to the partnership with the vendors. If you request that a certain composition doesn't have that particular fiber in it, and then you test it and that fiber is in there, that maybe you're not partnering with the right vendor.
Yeah, that's very true. Like you said, getting it right at the initial stages saves you a lot of waste in terms of cost, in terms of time, in terms of materials. So yes, I think that, yeah, that partnership with the mill is critical. Now, I think that in addition to sustainability, I'm seeing that more and more brands, even fast fashion, are starting to bring in premium materials. They're doing limited collections, or they're doing what you might call premium collections. And it looks like the key aspect of that is really upgrading the materials. What are you seeing happening?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, when we talk about exclusivity, that's definitely one plus that you can give to your consumer out there, to offer something that is exclusive that they can't find anywhere else. But definitely, I think one of the biggest risks that I hope the brands are going to continue to steer away from is to chase the cheapest material out there. Like we said, there's never that chase, it never ends. You can always go cheaper and cheaper. And that has proven to be the wrong way to go. Educating your employees that are making sourcing choices into why it's important to pay a little bit more for a certain material, it's imperative. And educating also your consumer, giving the consumer a more valuable item and explaining why that costs a little bit more, but this is what you're getting for it. I think it's the way to go and to manage the risks out there. The requesting discounts, to the constant request of discounts and the constant request for a less expensive fiber, less expensive fabric, really doesn't do anybody good. There has to be an understanding that if they're giving you an extra discount, yes, there are some economy of scales, obviously, and there are some ways to manufacture that fabric more efficiently, but continuous push to the vendor to make it for cheaper and to make it also faster. There has to be an understanding that the vendor at some point is going to have to cut corners. The vendor at some point is going to have to introduce, even without telling you, a different material source somewhere else in order to make it cheaper for you. So the push for the increased margin, the economy out there is extremely difficult for mid-tier company, for smaller company, for huge corporations. And the push on the margin is very strong. But like I said, there has to be a return to the quality, a return to offering more valuable goods to the consumer, because otherwise we're never going to get out of the situation where we are now. We're always going to keep hearing about the stories that are out there that we're talking about nowadays.
Yeah, I think that's really interesting. In a sense, you can't really save your way to success. You can continue to cut, but eventually you're cutting into your own long-term success by trying to continue to push on price.
Absolutely, absolutely. The push on price, I think, is the riskiest game to play.
And it's interesting because that has really been the way the industry's functioned for, I would say, decades, right? It's always been chasing price and always trying to figure out either where we can move geographically to get a better price, or how we can in some way re-engineer, right, a product in order for a lower price.
Exactly. And also, by doing that, unfortunately, we have put some suppliers out of business. There is no way out. If you keep trading down, you are hurting your brand, yourself, and the consumer eventually is going to figure it out and it's not going to come back. And also, you keep trading down, the higher tier manufacturers and vendors out there at some point are not going to are going to go out of business. You're hurting the entire ecosystem out there. You're hurting the entire supply chain.
It's interesting because there definitely is a floor on worse. And at some point, you can't get any worse. Whereas better, you can continue to upgrade and find ways to add on and improve. And I think that right now, in a sense, we've hit that bottom, right, on trying to make things cheaper.
Absolutely.
We've gotten as low as we can go.
Absolutely. And that's why we shouldn't be surprised when we hear the stories that we're hearing nowadays in the press, because it's the entire system brought it there, forcing the suppliers to make certain choices in some cases in order to stay relevant for their clients.
Right, because like you said, they have to stay alive also. And at the end of the day, yeah, if you push them too hard on price, they're going to have to find a workaround one way or another.
They will. And if you don't have an open communication, that's why I was talking about partnership. And that's why I think that's extremely important for the brands, for the retailers to have a certain knowledge inside the company when it comes to raw materials. Because that knowledge, it's going to preserve you from having huge headaches down the line. And that knowledge also, it's there to establish certain partnership with the vendors. The partnership with the vendors is the most important thing that you can ask for. It's a common understanding of the criteria that we have to apply, of the quality that we want to get out of the process that we want to. If there is no communication, if there is no partnership, then there is going to be problems. There is going to be quality issues. There is going to be returns. There is going to be second choice materials and all that. That, as we know, it's a huge cost.
Yeah, that's definitely. You talked about that partnership with mills or suppliers. In your opinion, what do great mills or suppliers do that others don't? What differentiates those guys?
Yeah, definitely capabilities of communicating. Communicating with your clients from the vendor perspective. They are all around all the time now, right? Like the times of the big fairs, yes, are still there. Hopefully we're going to resume those soon. But the vendors are all in your office every day showing you something. They have to be. They have to be in your face. They have to sell you something, right, all the time. So that's already there. They're all doing it. But what's important is establishing that communication with your vendor and agreeing on the expectations. Seeing these beautiful collections out there doesn't mean anything if they're not backed up by a consistent product when it comes to bulk. Too often, we fall in love with the collections and with the novelties and with the performance and with the colors that a vendor has to offer. And then when we go into bulk with that, there is so many disasters. And then there is that, oh, but if you told me that you would have used it for these, then I would have made it another way. And there is always some sort of miscommunication in a global world like we are right now, where there's different language barriers, there's cultural barriers. It's not easy to do business with other countries. And that all plays a role in the partnership and the communication that you need to establish with your vendor. And agreeing, like I said, on mutual expectations. The service is definitely one of the most important things that a great meal and a great partner can do today.
In terms of getting better communication, brands have been reducing the number of people on their staff who bring that technical expertise.
Yeah, that is true, and that is extremely sad. And all we can hope for is that once the world is going to reopen and once the economy is going to be in a more uplifting situation, that is going to revert itself. And some of these people are going to be hired again, because I think it's a huge gap And I know that a lot of them are relying more, but cutting that knowledge internally, it makes you rely more on your vendor. So that partnership with the vendor, it's if anything, it's even more important, because now the knowledge has to come from the vendor to tell the people that are not really experts what they're supposed to do. So the trust and the partnership, it's even more important.
Yeah, I think that's a good point, because even before the pandemic, we continually heard from suppliers that brands were cutting back on people who had that technical expertise. They were hiring more people who had a design inspiration, but didn't really have the training in terms of any of the manufacturing or the technical aspect that's critical in terms of producing a product that fits people, that wears well, that performs properly.
Absolutely, absolutely. I couldn't agree more. That is definitely a trend that unfortunately has been going on for quite a while, and that you see also in other countries like Italy, that has a great history of craftsmanship. And when you go to visit the sewing lines now, there are some younger generations doing it, but very few of them. And the last bits of the older generations that are doing it are less and less out there. So it is scary to think that craftsmanship is going to go away at some point because of the lack of people that want to do it, that are interested in doing it, but also because of the lack of education from the consumer and from the market that might not look at that craftsmanship as being valuable. And like we said, the chasing of the cheaper price and educating the consumer to pay always less and less for a product is definitely not the way. It's definitely not a sustainable way. I think the anchor of the sustainability is make a product that lasts a lifetime and not make a product that disappears and shrinks and peels after three times that you wash it, or you have holes in it and you have to throw it away and buy a new one. And that's probably the best way that we should tackle sustainability.
Yeah, I think so too. I think that it's really a mindset shift that will evolve, as you were saying, over time when people go back to the way, or maybe not go back, but start to rethink that way that you want to buy something that's very good quality. You're willing to pay more for it because you're not buying so many things. So when you're buying fewer, you have a budget to be able to buy better.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's the mentality, honestly, of our parents. When I grew up, I grew up in Italy, and that was the mentality that I remember being instilled from my parents, was that we're buying this coat and it costs this much money because it's great quality and we can use it for, you know, so many years. And it got a lot lost. So different generations, definitely. But hopefully I see a little bit of a comeback to that. And I think we can only be hopeful that's gonna keep growing for the younger generations.
My parents were the same way. My mother would check the seams on a dress before we bought it. She didn't want to see threads hanging. She'd feel the fabric. She'd decide if it was good quality or not. My father would look at shoes to see what the stitching was like. So the mentality, you're right, was you buy it and you wear it until either you outgrow it or it falls apart. And it wasn't expected to fall apart anytime soon.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that's the greatest thing, that going back to our conversation about luxury, that is the greatest thing that you can offer to your consumer. It's a durable item.
Quality will become the new luxury.
Absolutely.
So speaking of suppliers as partners, ideally, what would you like mills or other suppliers to be able to provide that they're not providing now?
I think we're going back to, I think we would all agree that the answer to this question is transparency. And there are so many great suppliers that are doing it already, and they have invested a lot in it, and they are continuously investing in it, and other suppliers that are still a little bit behind. Definitely, transparency is the best value that a supplier can offer to a brand and to a retailer out there in today's market.
Yeah, I think that's very important. If you're looking at brands and retailers in terms of material sourcing, are there any overlooked opportunities or missed opportunities that you're seeing?
the missed opportunities, or what I think more in terms of educating your consumer to learn about the materials that you have used. I think that's what the brand should focus on. Telling the story to the consumer, like we said before, why am I charging you a little bit more on this? It's because the fabric comes from Ireland and it's made, it's woven in a mill that's 300 years old. And that's all part of what we were saying before, the beauty of buying an item that lasts longer. It's also, you need to educate the consumer to do that. If you're educating the consumer only based on a price point of view, if that's the only story that you're telling, I think that is definitely a missed opportunity. Having the sales force out there or your website or explaining what's behind the craftsmanship and the processes and the beauty that's behind the making of the garment, that also, I think it's an opportunity to be out there and tell and gain more consumer, because you do have a story to tell. You do have beautiful materials that are made this way and not that way for a reason, and they use cleaner chemicals. You can tell that story. There are cleaner chemicals out there to use, and when you partner with a supplier that does amazing things, there are so many. There's so many out there that have great stories to tell right now. Whether it is, like we said, the going back to the farmers, linking your consumer to the beauty of a New Zealand farm, treating the animal humanly, that's using biodiversity. I think those are the opportunities that the fashion industry has going forward.
I think that's really interesting to point out and to frame it that way. I think is very important. You were telling me that you're starting a new venture called Studio VP. I'd love to hear about what you're doing.
Yes, absolutely. I'm very excited to utilize my knowledge, to utilize the partnership that I made in the past 20 years with so many vendors out there all around the globe, and to bring this technical knowledge and vendor base to clients that are looking for sourcing raw materials in a sustainable way, clients that are looking for new vendors for whatever reasons, clients that can't travel, unfortunately, because of COVID, and they can't go to PV or to Milano Unica to find the vendors, and that don't have this established vendor base, and doing it as a consultant, knowing also how difficult it is nowadays for the companies to hire full-time employees again. And hopefully, like we said, this is going to change going forward. But providing this service on a project base with seasonal research that checks off any criteria that my client might need, whether it's in region to be closer to the manufacturing point, whether it's at a certain price point, whether it's, like we said, checking off sustainability checkboxes. That's what I love to do, and I love to use my expertise to elevate the brand.
That sounds fabulous. I think that that's something that people really need right now, because like you said, people aren't traveling the way they used to. I think that even after the pandemic, it'll take a very long time, if ever, for people to be traveling as frequently as they did back then. So to be able to have somebody like yourself and like your company to be able to do that on the groundwork for them will be important, particularly because you do bring that expertise.
Absolutely. And it's difficult to work on material. It's a product that you need to touch and feel. That is probably the most difficult, the design definitely, and people that do work on the product are having a really hard time to do it from home and not doing it in an environment where we can sit at a table and touching and feeling the collection. I have to say there is a lot of shipping of boxes back and forth from everywhere right now, but that's all we can do. So it helps if there is an expert that knows where to look for, and it's as easy as making a phone call. I know the collections, and they send me the novelties, and it's all at my fingertips. So it's definitely easier when you have that knowledge and that vendor base to put together a selection. Also understanding the aesthetic and understanding the needs of your client, that's extremely important to make a selection that is meaningful.
Yes, that's true. We have to have the sustainability side, but we also have to have the aesthetic as well in order to sell the product.
Yes, and then the sensibility to understand the different clients' needs, that is definitely, that comes with the experience, absolutely.
Yeah, for sure. So where are people able to find you? Can you share your website address?
Yes, absolutely. My website is studiovp.io. Very simple, and you can send me a message from a page there.
And I'll also make sure to put the website and any contact details in the show notes for this episode. So they'll be in the show notes. And
oh, thank you so much.
Yeah, and they'll also, we have a dedicated website for this program, so they'll also be available there. So we'll make sure that's there and be very easy for people to find, because I'm sure a lot of people are going to want to reach out to you and understand even more about what you're doing, because I think that this is really the right service at the right time.
Great, absolutely. Thank you so much.
Veronica, it's really been wonderful talking to you. I've learned a lot. I think you've had so much to share that a lot of people are wondering about, whether they be a brand or whether they be a supplier. I think you've really brought a lot of very interesting insights to the table.
Thank you so much, Jane. It's been such a pleasure to connect with you, such a pleasure to talk to you. You're such a wealth of knowledge, and I love what you do.
Oh, thank you so much, Veronica. Wow, it means a lot to me to hear that. Thank you.
Thank you.
If you enjoyed this episode of A Seat at the Table, join me each week when I sit down with leading executives, entrepreneurs, educators, and authors who share their insights, experiences, and future vision for business. And make sure to visit Spin Expo. From trend information to technical innovation, Spin Expo is the primary exhibition for yarns and knitwear. The fair provides well-edited forums featuring high-quality products that are bursting with creativity. To learn more, go to spinexpo.com. That's SPINEXPO.com. You can also find a link in the show notes for this episode. Before you go, our current situation and sourcing report is now available. Find out more in the show notes. And don't forget to check out our new podcast website, where you can find all the episodes of A Seat at the Table, the show notes, plus lots of other useful information. You can find it at www.seat.fm. That's SEAT.FM. FM because it's a podcast. Thank you for joining me today. I'm Jane Singer, and I'll see you in the next podcast episode.